John, welcome to Durkeyville here at Craig Airport. I'm Joel Wiener, the Flying Wiener. And behind me is my 421 that I manage for a local company. And we've had this for about a year and a half. John has been my backup pilot in this airplane since the day we got it home. And we've had a lot of fun flying this machine and several others that we'll walk around and look at today and talk about our trips we've taken all over the Southeast and some take us all over the Caribbean.
This is true. All right, so you introduced yourself. I'm just a pilot from Florida. Let's talk about some of the basics. When did you start flying, Joel, and where did you get started?
I got my first airplane ride when I was 8 years old from my uncle Francie, and I guess everybody
said... Is that in the caveman days?
That was way back, you know, in the 80s when I had hair. and I just loved being around airplanes. My grandfather had an airplane, my uncle had an airplane, and they gave me a ride when I was 8, and I remember the 172, and I'd be looking out the window, and he'd let me fly, and I was looking at the turn and bank, trying to keep it level, and that's where I've got my start. And when
what
I turned,
did you say that was?
That was back mid-80s. I started taking flying lessons in 1990, solo, and got my license in 1991.
Where'd you
start? York, Pennsylvania is where I got my license. I flew out of several airports there in Pennsylvania, Gettysburg, Hanover, and York were the local airports that I rented airplanes from. And in 1991, I got my private. I thought that was great. And in 1993, I moved to Florida and went to a full-time flight school here in Jacksonville. It was called Shields Aviation. And in 1993 and 1994, I did my commercial multi-engine instrument, CFI, and multi-engine CFI.
Right.
And since then, I've been flying. I try to go fly every day. That's what I like to do.
And we are at the airport, guys. You can hear airplanes in the background and hot rods and stuff like that. So excuse the noise.
That there was the beaver that just taxied by on floats.
Yeah, that thing's
he's going to go out and have some fun today.
What brought you to Florida? What made you move from Pennsylvania down here?
I wanted to go to flight school, and when I came to Florida, I looked at the Shields Aviation here in Jacksonville.
At this airport?
At this airport. It's where the L3 Communications Flight School is now.
Okay.
And I went to Embry-Riddle, went to FIT. Also, Comair Aviation Academy, remember that in DeLand?
I'm not familiar with
Sanford, actually, but I went there and I toured all the flight schools and I decided Jacksonville would be my location. I moved in here in April of 1994 and I haven't looked back.
Yeah, you're pretty thoroughly embedded in Jacksonville, that's for sure, especially in the aviation scene. Let's talk about where you've worked since you got your ratings and stuff. So, jobs regarding aviation and stuff that you've done over
I got out of flight school in 94 and I worked for a gentleman named Vinny Stigliano. Vinny was the airport guru of Craig back in the day. He did the traffic reports for the radio stations.
Oh, okay.
So I got into doing traffic reports. I did that from 1994 until 2013.
Man, that's a long
time. A couple thousand hours on a 172.
Yeah.
I had a lot of people working for me over the years. And that's how I got my start. I had 5,000 hours of single engine time and I never left the city.
Right.
We took off and fly 295 Beltway and report airplane accidents, or not airplane accidents, car accidents.
Yeah, yeah.
And we report to a dispatcher. We listened to the scanners back in the day when the scanners were the big thing at Radio Shack. And
it's funny that you say that about flying here from 94 to 2013. If you watch the content yesterday, one of the things that me and Jeremy were talking about is pilots nowadays that go to, you know, these big flight schools, you know, like ATP or something, and they go from 0 hours to 1,500 hours, and next thing you know, a year or two later, they're sitting right seated in an airline. I'm kind of the same like you. Like, I flew for a long time and built my time up kind of, I mean, the right way, I guess.
Yeah, well, you worked at Hurlong at the flight school, and then you got into flying, managing airplanes like I do, and then got into flying charters.
Yeah.
It worked out for you.
It's definitely worked out for me. That's cool that you did that for a long time. So from there, what'd you do?
The big hit, let's go back to 1996. I was flying for the gentleman that did the banner towing here in Jacksonville, Beach Banners. And November of 96, he came to me and asked if I wanted to buy it. And I thought, why not? I could tow banners on the weekend and fly traffic during the week and it was worked out good.
What a good decision. Right?
So in November of 96, I bought that business. I was working at the mall doing sales and things during, you know, for money back when I started
flying. What were you doing at the mall?
I worked at Radio Shack, and I sold anything and everything from Radio Shack.
Radio Shack. There's probably a lot of people that are watching don't even know what Radio Shack is.
Right. But I worked there. I got my degree in electronics in school, and then I worked in sales.
I could totally see that being.
And then when I moved to Florida, my job came with me because I worked at Radio Shack in Pennsylvania.
Right.
So I already had a job when I moved here. It worked. So I worked odds and ends at the mall business, and it was evenings and weekends normally. Flew the traffic reports morning and afternoon.
Yeah.
We flew 7 to 9 in the morning, 4 to 6 in the afternoon. And on the weekends, I'd fly Bandit to the beach.
That's cool.
And,
what, if you don't mind me asking, what you paid for a beach banner back in 1996?
It's,
you don't have to say, it'll show
the time. I had to borrow some money, but what's really crazy is what I paid for the business then, I paid more for just one airplane last year.
Right.
And what I paid for the airplane and the business in 1996.
Right.
Went well, towing banners, and then we had 9/11, which I remember I bought my third airplane the week before 9/11. And I was here at the airport working on my hangar door over at the Bragg ramp.
Yeah.
And got a phone call. They said, hey, you need to go watch TV. So I went over to the FBO, and I walked in as the second airplane was hitting the tower. And that, they shut down their general aviation basically was shut down for 6 weeks.
Yeah.
So we didn't do any traffic reports. I had zero income for 6 weeks. And here I am, I just, you know, young businessman trying to get started. And I went from making a little bit of money to nothing. And it all worked out. We made it work and we're back working. But though I remember those days, and I had a few customers. I flew for a dentist, and he had a private airstrip down in Waleca, Florida, and he wanted to get his 206 from this airport to his, and you have to file IFR. Well, you can't file IFR to a grass strip. So we had to file from a VOR radio. I had to call.
Jeez.
And we had to fly, applying for the 186 degree radio at 53 miles, and then you have to land and then call and cancel in, you know, your flight plan with the phone.
How flying has changed.
And now we open four flight, flight plans, and it's a little different nowadays.
So you talked about the Beach Banners stuff. Tell us about that business, the banner towing.
The banner towing, we fly Piper Cubs. We'll go and look at those in a minute. They're modified with a lot of the lip mods, so the vortex generators.
For stall speeds and stuff.
Stall speeds, larger propellers, bigger engines that would normally come in the Cub. And basically we pick up a sign and we fly up and down the beach, or we do Will You Marry Me's, Happy Birthdays, we come to people's backyards, parties. The latest big thing is reveal parties. It's a girl, it's a boy. We come, blue banners and pink banners. It's something different that you can do for a reveal party.
Yeah.
People don't think about it.
Yeah, that's real cool. So, how many planes are doing the beach with banner towing?
Back in the years, I grew the business. In 2012, I had 5 tow planes, and I've worked basically from Daytona to Myrtle Beach doing a lot of flying. I've narrowed that down. I only cover from St. Augustine to Brunswick now, Brunswick, Georgia. And I just have two tow planes now.
Right, right.
And I've focused my business into airplane management side of things, and it's year-round business.
Of course.
Where the banner tow business is seasonal. It starts spring break and runs about Labor Day.
Something interesting about the banner towing that I've noticed just looking on the outside, because I've never done any banner towing for you, but I've seen a lot of young pilots, guys that have went on and did big things that have started. You know, we talk about paying it forward and, you know, the next generation of pilots. Joel has gotten a lot of guys started in flying by employing them at Beach Banners.
Beach Banners, I helped a lot of people in the traffic business.
Yeah.
We did traffic reports, and I can't count how many pilots I helped go from 300 hours. And back in the day, when you got 800 or 900 hours, they'd run off to the airlines, and then we got the 1,200 hour mark, and then now the 1,500 hour mark.
Yeah.
And the average pilot stays with me 2 years.
What is there any pilot by name that you can think of that has went on and is flying something really cool right now?
I've got people that call me. Ryan Burnett is the latest one that's called me. I started him from scratch in 2008 or 9. He's now upgrading to wide bodies at Delta.
Awesome.
He was an Envoy for a while, and ExpressJet and a few other ones over the years. But he calls me and...
That's cool.
And I flew his son, 2-year-old, has cancer, and I've been flying him back and forth to Atlanta for treatment. That's what got us back together last fall. And I've had some customers help out by donating the airplane and some fuel to get
Is there any way for people to donate to that, like GoFundMe or anything?
We have, and we can tagline that. Okay. He's got a personal website. And
that's a good cause.
And you know Miss Kelly, we've been flying her for years. Her husband died of cancer, and she said, hey, take him up there and take care of it.
So you're using her plane?
Yeah. Oh, awesome. Very nice.
Let's talk about, we talked about flying for a little bit. Let's change it up. What do you like to do? What is Joel Wiener like to do for fun outside of flying? But I know, like me, every day you're doing something in regards to flying, but what can we find you doing outside of flying airplanes?
If you don't find me at the airport, you'll find me at the marina on the boat.
Do you own any boats?
I own some over the years. Last year I sold them all because everybody wanted to buy a boat.
Yeah.
And I'll buy one back. But I've had a 42-foot houseboat for 16 years.
I saw that.
And I've stayed there for... the marina was my second home.
So. Okay.
Lived at the marina for a while. It's flying and floating. What else is there?
Pretty much. In regards to flying, what are some of the cool places that you've been?
Over the years, I've flown for a lot of customers. And majority of the people here in Jacksonville, they have second homes either in the Bahamas or Caribbean. Also, Asheville. And I know you do a lot of flying to Asheville and
Hickory. Yeah.
And up there in the mountains. And those are the normal hops for here. I did a lot of flying for the marinas out in the Panhandle. I flew for Legendary Marine for 6 years and did a lot of flying to different marinas across the country. They own 30 or 40 marinas. And we did a lot of real estate flying. And then I got into flying for Firehouse for 11 years, and with Firehouse Subs, I got to be part of the family, and they're team players and flying for Robin and Chris, and I got to go as they grew their business from 400 stores to 1,200 stores. We would fly to grand openings, go to the, you think, Subs, well, they're selling a million subs a week, so somewhere you use the bread factory,
right.
The brisket factory, the turkey, where they buy the turkey, where they buy the pastrami. We go and visit all these distributors, and it's really neat seeing the big picture of how everything operates in a large business.
Right. How long are you planning to fly for? Well, how long have you flown for now, total years?
Flying, licensed in 91, so it's 31 years now.
31 years, and how long do you think you're going to continue?
I'm going to fly as long as I can see out.
Keep a medical certificate.
That's right, as long as I keep a medical certificate and I can get in and out of the airplane.
I could see that, yeah. It definitely fits you.
I know people that are in their 80s and still fly, and they love it.
That's, of course.
Yeah. Flying for fun would be different than flying for a job. But for fun, you'll see my Piper Cub. I'll go out up and down the beach on a Sunday morning and just have fun. You know, low and slow. And that's my favorite airplane.
Piper Cub. What is it about the Piper Cub that you like?
You fly. You know, you're driving, flying down the road, and there's a semi passing you on 995 because you're flying 50 and he's doing 80.
Right.
You know, and it's just fun to low and slow, and the windows open, the doors open, and it's a motorcycle with wings.
Yeah, I get it, 100%. I've flown a couple hours in a Piper Cub, but not a lot. But I totally understand what you're saying.
Yeah.
What are some of the changes that you've seen in the airport? Specifically here at Craig Airport over the years, either good, bad, or indifferent?
As the airport grows, and I've been here 30 years, the biggest change was in 2002 and 3 when they put the fences up. Before the fences, you'd have people drive right up to your hangar with their kids, and they get out and look at the airplane, give the kids a ride. Well, now, you can't get on the airport unless you go through an FBO office, which they have their own, everyone has their own little security.
Right.
And as you get into larger airports, they've got security where you can't even go to the airplane. So you got to be escorted through the gate.
Do you think this had a negative effect on people coming up to the airport?
I think it's had a negative effect on pilot training for the last 20 years. And now we're not getting the home you know, hey, we're going to go see Uncle Joel at the airport. And,
right.
You know, my nieces and nephews, they all get airplane rides because I'm going to see them. Right. My brother comes to Jekyll Island, goes on vacation. I go give him a ride. That's what we do.
Right, right.
And I hope one of them gets home. That's the goal.
I did too. What, so that's kind of a negative thing. What about anything positive that you've seen change over the years, like Craig?
Here, positive, there's some growth, there's some hangers. I'd like to see some more, because as we the economy grows, travels more.
Hangers are very hard to come by.
Hangers are hard to come by. There's a list, and as you know, you and I could use two or three more hangers right now, because there's customers wanting to buy airplanes.
Of course.
And you don't want to leave an airplane outside. It's an asset.
Yeah. Okay. What are some of your, what's a favorite FBO, your favorite FBO and your least favorite FBO?
I don't know if we want to go in the least favorite, but I would say the strangest FBO used to be Tallahassee Commercial, which was a little strip, 3,000 foot strip north of Tallahassee. It's no longer there. I think there's apartments there now. But the old gentleman that ran it, we go out there and tow banners for Tallahassee football games. And he had an old pickup truck. You know, floorboards were out of it. And he said, don't put more than about $3 of gas in it because the gas tank would leak. But that was probably the strangest over the years. Some of the nicer and newer FBOs, Banyan in Fort Lauderdale, it's immaculate.
FXC.
FXC,
yeah,
and
it's
large. It's got a lot of things to do there for pilots. So if you're there, stuck there for the day, they've got a restaurant right on the airport. They've got a pilot store right on the airport. Maintenance for anything you want to do, you know, and obviously free coffee and tea. You know, that's the most important part.
Right.
Some of the other ones across the country, it's really neat. I went into Unke, New Mexico the other day. Same trip, self-serve, and a porta potty. But we couldn't get across the Rockies without a little more jet fuel, so we stopped in at Unke and got some gas.
I imagine it wasn't too expensive.
Well, it's yeah, 2 weeks ago it wasn't as expensive as it is today.
Wow. That's a whole other discussion.
We'll get into that.
What about, I won't say your least favorite, but FBOs or maybe even destinations that when a customer calls, you're like, maybe I should send someone else on this
trip. There's some Bahama stops that sometimes the paperwork is pain. I love all the islands. I've been to every island that has a runway in the Bahamas for over the years, on down into Dominican Republic and over to Punta Cana and into over the Virgin Islands, Anguilla, St. Kitts. And we were just talking the other day about doing a trip down there. And you can't get there without a fuel stop in the machinery you and I are flying. I have been there, and not this one, but the other 421, right after the hurricanes of, was it 17 or 18?
Yeah.
Where they had back-to-back hurricanes in the Virgin Islands. We actually flew some supplies down. I worked for a lumber company, and we were able to go in and get some orders and help people out immediately
right
after the storm. You never think of this, but the biggest thing they needed was water tanks and gutters, because there's no water there unless the rainwater they catch off the roof.
Yeah,
so they need to get the gutters back up and rainwater
for
tanks.
Rain catch.
Yeah, catching the rain. It was interesting to see what their first needs were. Obviously, they were going to get the hotels and everything back open, but the first needs was, hey, we need water.
Right.
So that was so what we packed up: generators, air compressors, tire plugs. It was, you know, a little different, and a few chainsaws, because everything was down sideways. Power line, every power line on the island was down. So,
all right. I forgot to ask you, how many hours do you think you have now? And I know it's hard to keep track of everything because, like me, you fly so many different airframes. But
I fly, but my iPhone keeps up with my flying now, and I've actually logged about 13,000 hours, a little over 13,000 hours in the logbook. And that doesn't count my Sunday afternoons going out and flying the J3
Cup.
So flying.
That's keeping stuff currency and all that.
I've been to, like you, simulator training. We go every year. Multiple airplanes now.
So we talked about some of the basic stuff. So I got a couple more questions and then we'll wrap this up. I know some of the people at home probably want to know. Is there any cool stories that you want to tell? Anything that just instantly pops to your mind, like, oh, this was cool, something that, you know.
I remember the first time I took off, and we did traffic reports, so we take off out of here at 7 in the morning. Well, sometimes you take off at sunrise, and that sea fog rolls in. and then you've got a solid layer of fog. And I remember flying around the city of Jacksonville, and they were 1,500 feet, and the fog rolled in at 300 feet, and the buildings and all the antennas stick out, and you're flying around.
So we had to switch cameras. Apparently, I guess we were so long-winded that the memory cards were getting maxed out. We only have a couple more things we're going to talk about. Joel, go ahead and finish on the emergencies.
So I've had one off airport landing. Everybody talks about you landing off field. So,
yeah.
1997, March of 97, I was teaching in a Piper Tomahawk. For those that don't know, it's a PA-38. Flight schools had a bunch of them back in the day. There's still a lot of them out there.
Yeah.
And we were doing maneuvers south of Deep Forest here in Jacksonville, and about 2,500 feet, and the old engine decided it wanted to stop. So I went over, and where I landed was the overflow parking in a TPC park, at the TPC, the big gray parking lot, which is now grass. I landed in there and left 870 foot of skid mark in the grass and on the stone.
Were you by yourself or you had a student?
I had a student with me. And we stopped about 12 feet short of the fence.
Jeez.
So no scratch to the airplane. The airplane, I think, went to a flight school out in Pensacola after
that. What was
that.
Wrong with the airplane?
It had a problem with the carburetor. So it would run at idle.
Yeah.
But it wouldn't run over after 1,200 RPM. It'd just cough and spit. And so I remember they went out there in a rollback, took the wings off, brought it back here the next morning, put the wings on, and the FAA came and they started the airplane, started right up at idle, and I'm like, oh man, what happened? And they went to add power and it quit, and I'm like, there we go.
So
it had a carburetor problem, and that's why you check your maintenance.
For sure. All right. One last question. Is there anyone over the years that you knew that maybe has passed away or no longer in aviation, or that you would consider a quote-unquote cowboy in the cockpit?
You know, I've got one that comes to mind, and he'll be watching this video and laugh, but we call him Nine Lives.
Nine Lives.
So Nine Lives flew for me for 4 or 5 years. He's crashed two of my airplanes. He was flying around New Year's Eve one year with his girlfriend, and had a bullet go up through the side of the airplane, through the side of his head, got him some stitches.
No way.
We found the bullet. It lodged in the airplane the next day.
He got shot in an airplane.
Yep, New Year's Eve, 2008 or 9.
You know, that's funny because you always hear about not shooting up for that, but that's literally...
Nine Lives is not forking in aviation anymore. Maybe that's a good thing for him, but, you know. He also, you know, he'd call and say, hey, man, I jumped off the pool last night, hit my head, and come in and he had like 13 stitches in the side of his head, and I'm like, well, you're not.
Why did he get out of aviation?
You know, I don't ask these questions. It might have been the best thing, and that's why he's still alive.
Nine lives. Does he still live in Jacksonville?
He still lives in Jacksonville. He's a good friend. I talked to him last week. But,
cool.
But Nine Lives, keep it going, and I hope you get back in the aviation again.
All right, so I think that was good enough for now.
We'll do a little tour of the hangar here and show you a few different things, and a cool airplane that I fly, we call it the piece of history.
Hey, is there anyone that you want to make a shout out to that's helped you over the years, or that you just want to say hi to or anything?
Man, everybody knows who they are. It's my three balls. Oh. I'm ball one, Bill is ball two, and Bob is ball three.
Three Balls Consulting.
Three Balls Consulting. I taught Bill and Bob how to fly, and you hashtag Three Balls Consulting, you can find us.
Cool. All right, hey guys, this was fun sitting down with Joel Wiener, a local living legend, just a pilot from Florida South.
Fly for fun.